The time has come to discuss the famous D'Alembert's formula for the wave equation. Now, what D'Alembert's formula does for us is it allows us to write down a solution to a general initial value problem for the wave equation. Now, this is a special kind of thing to be able to do because other PDE don't have formulas like this for their solutions. So let's get right to it. The initial value problem for the wave equation that D'Alembert's formula will allow us to solve is, well, it's the wave equation, which is UTT equals C squared UXX plus initial values. And our initial values will take the form of an initial position, so a known position at time 0, and that will be some given function f of x, and an initial velocity, ut of x0, so a known velocity at time 0, and that's going to be some function g of x. Now, the way to think about these physically, well, it's very simple. Remember that the wave equation really is just a formulation of f equals ma for a string, as you would learn through the video of the derivation of the wave equation. So really we're solving an f equals ma problem, and you know when you solve something like f equals ma, if you know the initial position and you know the initial velocity, then you know the trajectory of the particle. So it would make perfect sense that we would know the trajectory of the wave of the string, if we know the initial position and we know the initial velocity. So this is initial position, and this is initial velocity. The tool we're going to use to derive D'Alembert's formula is the general solution to the wave equation that we derived in the last video. So let's recall that real quick. I'll box it off up here. So recall the general solution to the wave equation is P of x minus ct plus q of x plus ct, where p and q are arbitrary, sufficiently nice functions, arbitrary functions. What we'll do now is something which is similar to what we do in ordinary differential equations when we have a general solution and we want to satisfy an initial value problem. We take the general solution and essentially plug in the initial values to figure out which general solution we have. So we will find P and Q by using the fact that we must satisfy these initial conditions. So let's write down our general solution as we did before. It's U of xt is equal to P of x minus ct plus Q of x plus ct. So this is the solution to the wave equation. Now we want to figure out what P and Q have to be to satisfy these two initial conditions. So along the way, we'll need ut. Let's compute that. Ut is, well, I'll have to use the chain rule, so minus c times p prime of x minus ct plus c times q prime of x plus ct. Okay, good. So let's use our initial conditions. We have u of x 0 equals f of x, but u of x 0 is simply plugging in t equals 0 into this formula. So this is the same thing as p of x plus q of x. All right, we're getting somewhere. And similarly, plugging in t equals 0 in the ut formula, that must be g of x, but that's also the same thing as minus c p prime of x plus c q prime of x. All right, so let's now just kind of box off these little formulas that we've got here. Remember, our goal is to find P and Q in terms of F and G, so we're partway there. The next step will be to get rid of the primes on the P and the Q. And the way to do that is essentially just to integrate this second equation. I'll be a little vague about it right now, but I'll be much more clear in a moment. So for now, let's just observe that we can choose a capital G such that capital G prime is equal to little g. Now, there's lots of choices for capital G, many antiderivatives, and if I choose correctly, if I choose carefully, I can choose one such that I have capital G of x equals minus c, and I take away the prime. So I've integrated both sides of the equation in just the right way that this antiderivative matches up with the antiderivative of the right-hand side. So what we'll do is essentially just get rid of this this equation right here. Let's cross it out and replace it with this guy. Okay, good. This is excellent because we can now solve for P and Q in terms of F and capital G. Let's do it. So I will do it up here, just to give us a little more space. If we do just a little bit of arithmetic here, divide the bottom equation by C and add them together, we'll find P of x is equal to 1 half F of x minus 1 over 2C capital G of x, and Q of x is 1 half F of x plus 1 over 2c g of x. So now we have P and Q in terms of F and capital G. But remember, if I know P and Q, then I know U by the formula for the general solution. So if we use this formula, we essentially have solved our problem. We still have this matter of figuring out exactly what g is, but we've essentially solved our problem. Our solution is u of xt, and that's equal to p of x minus ct, which is 1 half f of x minus ct minus 1 over 2c g of x minus ct plus q of x plus ct. So plus 1 half f of x plus ct plus 1 over 2c g of x plus ct. So let's figure out what's going on with this g, and then we'll have the full D'Alembert formula. So let's do that on the next slide.
So we'll start this slide with the last formula from the previous slide. Now, we're concerned with this capital G. We made a choice of antiderivative, and I was pretty vague about that choice. Now, the secret here is that, in fact, the choice doesn't matter. So let's choose a particular antiderivative. Let's use the fundamental theorem of calculus, and let's take capital G to be an integral from some starting point. Here's where the choice is. I have to start at some x naught, up to x of little g of s ds. Now, s is just a dummy variable for the integration. Now, let's examine this difference of two antiderivatives using this integral definition of the antiderivative that I've chosen here. So we take g of x plus ct minus g of x minus ct. Now, using this integral, that is the integral from x naught up to x plus ct of little g minus the integral from x naught up to x minus ct of little g. Now remember that if I have a negative of an integral, then I can change that negative to a plus so long as I integrate in the opposite direction. So I have to switch the bounds of integration. So I'll put the x naught up here on the top, and I'll put the x minus ct on the bottom. Also remember that If I integrate from a starting point, let's call it A, up to an ending point B, and then I integrate from B up to another ending point C, that's the same as integrating from the original starting point up to the final ending point. So I can combine these two integrals into the single integral from x minus ct up to x plus ct of g of s ds. Now you see that the choice of x naught is irrelevant. It doesn't matter. It was some point in this interval that I used to define my antiderivative. We've got everything in the form that we want it, and we're basically done. So let's just summarize what it is that we've done. We've solved the initial value problem for the wave equation. Which is the wave equation plus initial values u of x0 is some function f of x, and ut of x0 is some function g of x. So that's our initial value problem. That the solution to this initial value problem is given by u of xt equals 1/2, well, the first part right here, 1/2 f of x plus ct plus f of x minus ct plus this second part, but we'll write it in the integral form that is more convenient to use. Integral from x minus ct up to x plus ct of g of s ds. Now let's box it off just because it's so important. This is D'Alembert's formula for the solution to the wave equation. Just notice one thing before we finish here. Notice that the formula can be computed just by using f and g. So if I gave you the functions f and g, you can plug them into this formula and you get the solution u. So this will allow us to produce interesting examples, and that will be our next order of business.